Dear sisters and brothers in Christ, let us begin Good Friday noon service, meditation on the seven words of our Savior on the cross. In the name of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Christ was manifested in the body, vindicated in the spirit, seen by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed in and throughout the world, glorified in high heaven. Your response? Shall we sing to the glory of God the opening hymn, hymn number 139. O come and mourn with me a while. As we remain standing, Let us receive call to worship.
We shall join responsively in the call to worship.
Surely he took our infirmities and carried our sorrows. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us it is the power of God. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his words we are healed. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us it is the power of God. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By this you have been healed. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us it is the power of God. To this you were called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving us an example that we should follow in his steps. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us it's the power of God.
Please be seated. Let us enter into the act of confession. Let us spend a few moments in silence in the presence of God.
Let's all say together the corporate prayer of confession. Almighty and merciful God, we thank you for bringing life and peace for us through the shame, suffering, and death of your Son. Teach us to boast about nothing but the cross of Christ, and be willing to suffer gladly for his sake, and he will live and reign with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen.
Today, as a church, as we observe Good Friday today, the special day of God's death on the cross, shall we all look to the Lord in prayer, while praying together the collect, which is printed on the pew slip, page number 3. Merciful God, who in your love for the whole creation conquered death by the death and resurrection of your Son on the cross, thus redeemed the potter's field by the ransom of your Son Jesus Christ to find a solace for the dead, redeem the oppressed, we realize our weakness, awaken and enlighten us that we may find joy in practicing doing your will in our lives. In the name of God, who sent his Son to his world, the Christ who trampled death on the cross, and the Holy Spirit who continues to be a companion in our weakness, now and ever. Amen.
Now the scripture lesson from the Old Testament would be read to us.
The Bible reading for this Good Friday service is taken from Isaiah chapter 53, verses 1 to 12. Isaiah chapter 53, beginning to read at verse 1. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was a chastisement that brought us peace, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like the sheep that before his shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and for his generation who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken by the transgression of my people. And they made his grave with the wicked, and with the rich man in his death. Although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth, yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for the guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Here ends the reading.
Dear sisters and brothers in Christ, it's such a joy and blessing to gather in this manner, in this holy sanctuary, to meditate upon the seven words of our Savior on the cross. Every year we gather in this manner, we meditate, but every year there's a new revelation. The beauty of the Word of God is that any number of times you may meditate, every time there'll be new revelation. There'll be a fresh understanding of Scripture, and the fund of knowledge will never get exhausted, because this is the Word of God that has proceeded from the mouth of God. It contains the plan and purpose for each one of us. In 1867, Rose Hartwig Thorpe wrote a narrative poem, "Curfew Bell Must Not Ring Tonight," was the title. "Curfew Bell Must Not Ring Tonight." It tells the sad story of a young and beautiful girl called Bessie, whose lover, Basil Wood, was captured by the Puritans and thrown in prison. the judge sentenced him to be shot as a spy. That night, as the curfew bell rings, knowing that Oliver Cromwell, the English military general and political leader during the English Civil War, will be late that evening, the young woman, Bessie, goes to the church and begs the sexton. She asks him to delay or prevent or stop the ringing of the curfew bell. The old man, the sexton, refuses, after which Bessie, knowing that there's no other way to delay the execution, she climbs the bell tower. Risking her life, she tied herself to the clapper of the giant bell so that it would not ring. When the bell did not ring, the soldiers went to investigate. They found the girl battered and bleeding from being bashed against the sides of the bell. Oliver Cromwell, who had come, was shocked, at the same time impressed by her love and sacrifice for her lover. He was amazed at her courageous act, and as a response, he pardoned Basil Wood. The depth of someone's love is known to us from the sacrifices they make. The depth of someone's love is known to us by the benefits we receive in being loved. God is love. The love of God is supreme. It cannot be comprehended with human mind. God's love for us is higher than that of the human love, which cannot be fathomed or explained. God loves us with everlasting love. It is eternal love, and it brings us true joy and happiness. In God's nature, to act that way towards us is His own nature. God's love is self-giving, it is supreme, it is sacrificial. And this noon, as we are gathered in this holy sanctuary, we'll be reflecting on God's love that is expressed so powerfully through each word of our Savior on the cross. It is transcending, it's transforming, it's unconditional, unfailing, and without any expectations. God's love is a source of all change in us. God so loved each one of us that He sent His only Son to save us. He allowed His Son to be treated cruelly. He stood by and watched His innocent Son being nailed and to be hung on the cross in pain and agony. God could have rescued His Son. He could have punished all who were treating Him so brutally and maliciously. But God allowed His Son, who knew no sin, to become sin for us, for our sake, and to carry the sin of all humanity. God did this for each one of us because He loves us. Apostle Paul, underlining God's love, at the same time our unworthiness, writes in Romans chapter 5, verse 8, God proves His love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. God proves His love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. Jesus died for us even though we didn't deserve such a sacrifice. Again, Paul pointing out to Jesus' sacrificial, supreme, and self-giving love, he writes in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, he says, "And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. We have been saved by his life." On this Good Friday, as we ponder the seven words of our Savior on the cross, let us realize our unworthiness and how good God has been saving our lives and how we need to transform our lives to be his disciples, so much so that each one of us would be like Apostle Paul, who would say, "The life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." May God add his rich blessings as we meditate each word, and may our reflections enable us to be transformed so that we would be true disciples of Christ, seeking his will and doing his will for God's glory. Amen. Shall we rise to feet and sing hymn number 140? 140, "Forgive Them, O My Father."
Let us pray. Gracious and most loving God, as we gather together under the shadow of the cross that your beloved one, our Savior Jesus Christ, hung that day at Calvary, we pray, O God, that you would open our hearts and minds to the words that flowed out of our Savior,
that we would intentionally listen through our heart the very words of hope that enables us to sense the glory and grace that you have for us and our lives. For we pray this prayer in the name of the one who spoke the words of comfort and peace, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Dear sisters, brothers, dear children, I'm deeply grateful to God for yet another opportunity God has given to me to be here, especially on this poignant and deeply sorrowful day of suffering, and make sense of what is happening in and around and through the cross. My heartfelt gratitude to the presbyter in charge of this church, Pastor Reverend Dr. Vincent Vinod Kumar. Thank you very much, dear Aya, for constantly inviting me to this church and for your leadership and for your grace. Thank you very much, dear Aya. A gospel according to St. Luke in the 23rd chapter, beginning at verse 32. Verse 32 of the 23rd chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke. Two others also who were criminals were led away to be put to death with them. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." We are called to meditate upon the way of faith, unconditional forgiveness. And we were tracing the route that Jesus took in order to reach Calvary. And everything was set. Nothing is accidental in the scriptures. Nothing is coincidental. Everything is ordered by prophecies. And that's why it's important that we sense what is happening in, through, and across, within, and beneath the cross because of the scriptures. And as Aya rightly said, that every time we look at the scriptures, at all that it appears to be old is not at all, if we intentionally, most deliberately sense what is happening through the word. And this is what was happening. We begin with Ezekiel, how unlike, yet it is important. We look at Ezekiel sensing that the temple of God had been desecrated. Idolatry had set in. Everything that the temple stood for was no more the case. And as we know, the temple is the temple because of the glory of God. Ezekiel 10 says that the glory of God began to depart from the threshold of the temple. The temple is the temple because of the glory of God. And now it was no more the case. And that's why as the book of Ezekiel was about to end in Ezekiel chapter 43, the glory of God, which had departed earlier, begins to come back to the temple through the east. The glory of God prepares to come to the temple to restore the temple that has been desecrated, as we know, destroyed, rent asunder, idolatry set in, no more the temple, simply a building. And God wants to recreate that temple again. And that's why the glory of God prepares to come to the temple through the east. What happened on Palm Sunday was this. Jesus circles around Jericho, the place of palms, the place of perfume, through Bethphage, across the Mount of Olives, into Jerusalem through the east. It's not coincidental. A prophecy is about to be fulfilled. Gets into Jerusalem and imagine this, what happened yesterday. that he draws the one who are closest to him together and then gives them a new commandment. Love one another. Because it takes everything of love to approach the cross today. All, and it is tested like never before. And as we always know, love is not tested in places of comfort. Love is tested in places of despair and suffering. That's when love is tested to the core. And Jesus is led finally to the cross to be identified with those who were outside all the places of privilege. And that's why, as the great Saint Augustine would always say, the cross was a pulpit in which Christ preached his love to the world. And that is why that pulpit is to be heard once again. Because there was a clash between the East and the West. Because East is how God in Jesus Christ approached Jerusalem. West was a sign of power. Because Pilate had entered Jerusalem through the West that day, as we know from history. There's a clash that is set finally, a stage that has been set. A clash for glory on one side and the suffering of the cross on the other, being met at the cross. And that's why Jesus begins by a word. And that's why we need to look at creation, Genesis chapter 1, the first day of creation where God uttered the word, "Let there be." Let there be light. God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And Jesus, by the first word, what Jesus does is dispels all forms of darkness and hatred and separates love from hatred. That's what Jesus does in his first word. It's a new creation. Every word is a new creation because the temple has been desecrated. And as Paul reminds us, don't you know that you are the temple of the living God? Don't you know you are the temple of the living God? And that's why we are not pointing at anything but pointing ourselves today, knowing that this temple has been destroyed and it needs recreating. Jesus says, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Them, for they do not know what they are doing. It's about someone else that Jesus is speaking about. And this word is where in which both pardon meets judgment. There's pardon as well as judgment. We sometimes simplify it by saying, yes, everything is fine, everything is in order. Jesus has forgiven everything. Not necessarily. It is pardon, certainly, because in the ancient language, as we always have meditated right here, that the word for forgiveness and the word for unbinding is the same. When Jesus calls Lazarus out, Jesus says, "Unbind Lazarus." In the original language, it is the same word that is used for forgiveness. Jesus saying, "Forgive Lazarus, unbind Lazarus." And when Jesus says the same word today on the cross, "Unbind them," Jesus says. Unbind them. Who were bound? What was binding them? And from what they should be unbound? There may perhaps been soldiers who did not know who Jesus was. There were criminals across who knew perhaps who Jesus was, and yet possibly one of them appeared to not have cared at all. Pardon them. Pardoning is unbinding. And this is what God did at creation. God unbound creation to the extent that the glory of God filled all creation in light. What light does is this? that which is hidden, that which is concealed, will come to the light one day. And when it comes, there is a pardoning, certainly, that there is a dispelling of everything that blocks us from coming to God, darkness, that which separates us from God, that we are pardoned. What about judgment? There is a word of judgment that comes to us through the first word. Because if we make sense of forgiveness, it certainly is unconditional, and yet conditional to the fact that unless and until we forgive others, we cannot claim forgiveness at all. The Lord taught the prayer to his earliest disciples that you need to forgive others, and only when you forgive others, you would be forgiven. Because God is placing a lot of stakes in and around the cross that day. Because what God does is this: God, who chooses to bury our every act against God at the depth of the flesh of the bruised Son of God, Jesus Christ. And that's what God has done. Cleaves God's self in Jesus Christ, puts everything that we have done against God and seals that in the bruised body of Christ. And that's why Christ's body carries the depth of forgiveness right at the beginning of creation until then. And this is forgiveness. There is pardon indeed. Because imagine this, children, sisters, and brothers, that the hand which crafted the universe into existence is stretched out, and the same hand is bruised by every act of human beings, us. What kind of a God is this? Or what kind of human beings we are? And that's exactly why we need forgiveness. That's why we need forgiveness. That we have done things against each other and against God's church. And that's why we need mercy. With a word of judgment that if we keep on doing that, there is a final judgment that is about to come. And we should be aware of that. As much as we are forgiven, we are also called to judgment, to every act that we do against God and to God's church and to each other. Forgive them, for they do not know. What if we knew then of our acts? Should we be forgiven then? If we really know what we are doing, should we be forgiven then? We need to realize that there are things that we really know what we are doing. And that's why there is judgment. We really need to know, sisters, children, and brothers, that as we come to the end of our life, perhaps, we always have to realize a finitude of our own lives, knowing that nothing lasts forever. And that's why we need to constantly seek God's grace through the cross, knowing what we have committed against each other, against God's church, and certainly against ourselves, because we are the temple of the living God, and we are not ourselves but the temple. And may the rushing wind of God's power cleanse this temple once again as God seeks us to create us anew. Amen. As we seek God's grace, we call upon the choir to sing what Ecclesiastes sang: to everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to love and a time to hate, a time of war and a time of peace. Today is the time to mourn. Choir will now sing this passage from Ecclesiastes. And as they sing, if we would take time to read the last verse of the last chapter of Ecclesiastes, there is wisdom there. May God bless these words. Amen.
Reflection.
O my people, O my church, what have I done to you, or in what have I offended you? Answer me. I led you forth from the land of Egypt and delivered you by the waters of baptism. I went before you in a pillar of cloud. But you have led me to the judgment hall of Pilate. I scourged your enemies and brought you to a land of freedom. But you have scourged, mocked, and beaten me. I gave you the water of salvation from the rock, but you have given me gall and left me to thirst, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy is God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us.
Shall we all in unison say the following prayer? Gracious God, taught us to pray, saying, forgive our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. These words are too familiar to us, but not the action. We listen to your words calling us to seek forgiveness, and we are eager to seek that, since we need your forgiveness for our own well-being. We also listen to your words calling us to forgive others, that we show our unwillingness to do this, because we are careless for others. Of the cross, we listen to your prayers for forgiveness in the midst of suffering and rejection. May the cross help us to change our attitudes, cross over to your ways. Amen. Let us have the meditation on the second word, the word of salvation, led by Reverend Michael Jabraj.
The Passion Translation of the Bible reads, Luke 23, verse 42 and 43, this way. Then he said, I beg of you, Jesus, show me grace. Take me with you into your everlasting kingdom. And Jesus responded, I promise you, this very day, you will enter paradise with me. They are indeed the most powerful moments of transformation. Those moments that Jesus interacted with the thief, the penitent thief. Most powerful moments of transformation in all of history. For they reveal and demonstrate the power of truth. The truth that alone has the capacity to change lives and in fact the whole world. Did not Jesus say, I am the truth? And he went further to say, you shall know the truth and the truth will set you free. And here is a classic illustration of the power of the truth. When Jesus told the penitent thief, today you will be with me in paradise. At the outset, it is very important for us to understand that the most remarkable fact about this penitent thief is that he saw Jesus on that morning like nobody else around. Like nobody else around. He saw Jesus the way he claimed himself to be, Savior, King. He saw Jesus, he discovered Jesus as he revealed himself to be, Savior, King. And it is important and significant, and in fact it is very critical, because unless you see Jesus as he really is, you really cannot come to him as you really are. Like the penitent thief did. And so it was important for the thief to see Jesus as he really was, Savior, King. You see, there were all kinds of people. In fact, people all represented from every quarter of the city were there. Chief priests and the elders who were determined to execute Jesus with crucifixion. Pilate and Herod, who were the governing authorities of the day, they kind of went by the pressure of the people around. Soldiers, they simply mocked Jesus and insulted him. They dressed him with a robe just to mock him and then knelt before him as though he was the king. They gave him the staff and they beat him with that. And the people, the public, they insulted Jesus. In fact, they spat on him. And all of these was going on right from morning 6 o'clock right up to 9 o'clock. And here were the two thieves who were seeing and hearing all that was happening around. And then it was finally to the both the thief. The book of Nicodemus in Apocrypha names the bad thief as Dismas and the good thief as Gestas. Now here was Dismas responding to Jesus on the cross. Would he not save us? He was simply echoing what the rest of the people did. But Gestas, he saw something very different. And when he heard, like we heard the first word, Father, forgive them, that did it for him. And the superscription that he saw on the cross, Jesus, King of the Jews, did it further, and that was it. Because there he saw Jesus the way he really was, Savior, King. There he saw Jesus claiming himself to be the Savior and the King of the universe. It is interesting that Gestas addressed Jesus as Jesus. Because Jesus was a very familiar, popular name in those days. Old Testament Joshua. Parents would want to name the son Joshua with a desire for deliverance. In fact, archaeologists have discovered 71 individuals with the name of Jesus during the same time as Jesus in the burial caves about the same time of Jesus. But this Jesus was different. But you see, Joseph and Mary did not have the right to name him. In fact, angel Gabriel told them, this Jesus you are going to name because this is a choice of heaven. Because this Jesus is not just going to be the desire of the people of God, he is going to be the fulfillment of the desire of the people, the Savior. And his eyes now open to the fact that this Jesus on the cross is indeed the Savior of the whole world. And then he goes on to say, remember me in your kingdom. For he understood this king was someone different, because he saw all the people from the chief priest to Pilate to the people in public, anger, enmity, hatred, shame, the spat upon him, all of it. And as we read, he did not retaliate. You see, the other thief responded basis of people, but Gestas saw Jesus responding to the people, not on the basis of their reactions, but on the basis of who he was. A God of mercy, God of grace, God of love, who will reach out to the people who put him to shame and insulted him and went further to crucify him. He responded to all of these people by his love, grace, and mercy. And there he saw, this king is of a different order. He belongs to a different realm. He does not belong to the order of the Pilates and the Herods and the Caesars. He is someone, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who has authority over all of the universe, of all the kings everywhere. And that is why he now comes to him with that understanding. Now that he has understood, now that he saw Jesus as he really was, he now asks Jesus, pleads with Jesus, Jesus, would you please remember me when you come in your kingdom? You see, unless you see Jesus as he really is, you will not come to him as you really are. Sinner who needs the Savior. Because he saw himself in the light of who Jesus was, Savior and King. Last night we saw detached, so we remember, ask God to remember us. And now he was coming to Jesus. Jesus, my whole life I was a terrible thief. But would you please right now, I have come to the understanding of who you are. You are Savior, King. Would you please accept me, not on the basis of how my life had gone all these years, but would you please accept me on the basis of this moment where I have come to see you as the Savior and King of all the universe? Would you please accept me, remember me, as though Jesus was waiting for that moment, that very moment. He said, today you will be with me in paradise. Unless you see Jesus as he really is, Savior and King, you will not come to him as you really are, a sinner who needs a Savior. There is never a time in our lives that we do not need Jesus. There will always be a time when we would need Jesus. In fact, let us get this very clear. The greatest need at any given time for any individual, regardless of whatever, the greatest need at any given time, anytime, anywhere, is a need for Jesus. Gestas saw that, and he was promised the promise of eternal life, the life of paradise. By the way, and if you don't come to him as you really are, you do not receive the promise of life that Jesus promised. And so it all begins seeing Jesus as he really is, Savior and King. On the basis of who he really is, as is revealed to him, he comes to him as he really is, a penitent sinner. And then Jesus promises him, today you will be with me in paradise. What that word paradise means, we leave it to the Bible scholars, but I just do want to emphasize and focus on what it meant for this criminal on the cross. When Jesus said, you will be with me in paradise. Yes, it does refer to the heavens, paved with streets of gold, pearly gates, sun and moon, no need for sun and moon, because the glory of the presence of God, the brightness will fill. Majestic, beautiful. But you know what? It is not all those beautiful descriptions of the heaven that we all are waiting for the future that defines heaven. It is not those. It is the very presence of God that defines heaven. And Jesus clarifies to the criminal guesters, he says, you know, you will be with me in paradise. Where I am, if you are, that is paradise. That is heaven. And the interesting thing about this is this, that the life of paradise promise that Jesus offered the criminal is that to have the life of heaven, the promise of heaven, as a power to change your present. And that is why, you know, this criminal, Gestus, died in style. You see, cross was this, it was the worst form of execution. About 300 or 400 BC, the Persian discovered the worst form of execution by crucifixion. And the idea of crucifixion was simply this, slow death. In fact, we get the English word excruciating pain from crucifixion. The idea was to have the person on the cross be left to die. People would not bother for him. He will remain there for hours, sometimes overnight, sometimes a day or two. But listen to this. When he heard Jesus promising him the life in paradise, that moment, the promise of heaven became the power of paradise that very moment. There was darkness from that moment onwards for the next 3 hours, but there was light in his soul. The veil torn and people were terrified, but he walks into the veil because for him it was 24/7 communion with the Lord. And the earth shook, but he was unshaken on the inside. You know what? The remaining few hours before he closed his eyes, he lived his life, the promise of life, like many people do not experience all their life. The power of truth, that when you come to realize and see Jesus as he is, the Savior and King, and when you come to him as you really are, that the promise of life, even the life of the presence of God, invades you. And this is indeed the greatest need of the hour. The greatest need, as I told, the greatest need at any given time for anyone is the need for Jesus. This very moment, as you are seated with whatever the state of the mind is, the greatest need is the need for Jesus. And that need is to live in the presence of God, like the criminal did. And that made all the difference. And that's why he died in style, rejoicing in the promise, in the empowering presence of the Lord, the remaining hours of his life. He would have understood Psalmist saying in Psalm 16:11, you make known to me the path of life for the following hours. Maybe he was on the cross for the following several hours, maybe overnight. But those hours, those are the hours that defined him, not the all of his life, simply because of the power of the presence of God. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with the eternal pleasures at your right hand. And that was his experience. And Peter, who understood it further, he spoke in Acts chapter 3 to the people, repent, turn from your sin. You will experience refreshing times in the presence of the Lord. My dear brothers and sisters, the greatest need for all of us is to experience and to live in the presence of God. The age of enlightenment of the 18th century left us with the greatest tragedy of the past centuries. Tragedy bigger than the Holocaust and the world wars and perhaps even COVID put together. The tragedy and the curse of the divide between sacred and secular. Till then, whatever has been the understanding of God in man, he always saw God as a reference point whenever disaster or any phenomena struck the world. But from there on, from the so-called Age of Enlightenment, man relegated God to the corner and took the center stage. And today we are living in an age of disillusionment. Because man has brought upon himself problems that he cannot handle, issues that he cannot solve, and in fact he wouldn't want to solve. Example, even if it be climate change, or even the undercurrents that govern the nations of the world, undercurrents of power and money and position and pride, everyone knows those are the undercurrents that control the world. And these people would not want to come out of that as well, because that means power to stay in control. For all of these, the only answer is the presence of God. What the world needs today is an invasion of the presence of God. What our country needs, given the political situation and whatever, what our country needs is the intervention of the presence of God. And what we in our diocese, even as we're impending the bishop's election, what we need is the people who are standing for the election, although in groups, asking, inviting the presence of God into the election system. And for you and me, individuals, the greatest need is to listen to the invitation of Jesus to walk into his presence. You see, this is how he understood when Jesus told, "Today you will be with me in paradise." It all begins and stays where it is when we bring Jesus on the center stage and not relegate him to the corner like the criminal did. And this is the hope of the nation, hope of our churches, hope of our families, hope of our children and grandchildren, and hope of the world ahead. Walking into the presence of God every day of our lives. Amen.
Sincere thanks to Reverend Michael Jabaraj. At the same time, we would also take this opportunity to thank Reverend Ellen Palan also for ministering to us. Shall we sing hymn number 141, 141? Let us sing the alternate stanzas only, 1, 3, and 5.
please be seated.
Reflection. O my people, O my church, what have I done to you? Or in what have I offended you? Answer me. I led you through the desert 40 years and fed you with manna. I brought you through tribulations and penitence and gave you my body, the bread of heaven, but you have prepared a cross for my Savior. Holy God, Holy Mighty, Holy and Immortal, have mercy on us. Gracious God, you call us to repent and believe in the gospel. We desire to change our ways and return you, but the pleasures and pleasures of this world prevent us from doing so. We also listen to your calling to all those who carry heavy burdens in their hearts and your promise to give them rest. When we carry burden, we fall to the temptations of seeking relief from the sources which lead us away from you. Standing before the cross, we silent prayer and identify the kingship and your words of assurance and acceptance to him. May the cross help us to acknowledge you as the King and the cross over to you always. Amen.
Now let us meditate on the third word, word of affection. Woman, here is your son, here is your mother. Led by Reverend Dr. Ben Das.
Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for giving your Son to save us. We thank you for bringing us thus far. We thank you for giving us this opportunity once again to think about, to meditate upon, and to realize the wonderful meaning of each of your word from the cross. As we meditate on the third word, help us to understand the in-depth and contextual meaning of the word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Respected and dear Reverend Dr. Vincent Vinodachan, Sam Achan, team of pastors and preachers of the day, dear choir members, pastorate committee members, dear brothers and sisters, I am very much conscient about the limited time, so I will try to finish within the given time. But before that, before I start, I would like to read the verse, the Bible portion from which the third verse we read. Gospel according to St. John chapter 19, verses 25 to 27. I am reading from the NRSV. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus, where his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, He said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. Jesus uttered his third word on the cross while his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene were standing near the cross of Jesus. He saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her. In the synoptic gospel tradition, the women who followed Jesus stood at a distance, and all the other disciples were in flight. But John has the woman at the foot of the cross and his beloved disciple near them. According to the gospel author John, the rejection of Jesus by the leaders and the generality of people is countered by the faithful disciples who were beneath the cross at the time of his death. It is significant that among the four or five faithful disciples, about which we have some dispute, who stand at the foot of the cross, at least three, including Jesus' mother, are women. Mary, the mother of Christ, crying at the foot of the cross, has inspired many musicians to compose pieces reflecting the agony she was going through. Many compositions revering her have been composed, one of which was Sancta Maria, composed by Mozart. This is one of the famous prayers to Mary. Now I request the choir to sing Sancta Maria as is sung in the original Latin text.
Okay, they will sing after my sermon. Okay. There is a dispute over who the beloved disciple was.
As we read in verse 25, I shall read that verse again. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother, number one, and then his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. Only three names are told out there. There were only three women beneath the cross, and there is no mention about anyone else, particularly any man. This would lead one to assume that the disciple whom he loved would be one of these women who are named in verse 25. On the basis of this, some theologians have identified the beloved disciple as Mary Magdalene. But there are theologians who say that the beloved disciple was a man, referring to Jesus' usage, "Here is your son." Anyway, this third word of Jesus on the cross bears two meanings this day. Number one, Jesus values human relations. On the cross, while expecting death, Jesus was anxious about the future of his mother. The Son of God understands the pain of a mother who loses her son. He was trying to solace her by filling the gap in the relationship Though it may not be possible in its fullness, it was the only thing that he can do while he is on the cross. He knows that as a beloved son, it was his responsibility to take care of his mother in human life. But since it was impossible for him to do because of the crucifixion, he wanted to safeguard at least his mother and depute a person to take care in his absence. It is a lesson for all of us to value human relations while being spiritual. Our commitment to do God's ministry or our busy schedule of our professions or anything of that sort do not justify our negligence in taking care of our parents and our fellow humans. As human beings, we have to fulfill our responsibilities on earth as a son, as a daughter, as a husband, as a wife, as father, as mother, as a neighbor, as a friend, and so on. While completing God's mission on earth, if the Son of God was careful about human relations and his duties and responsibilities, in those relationships, we cannot surely forgo. Secondly, Jesus reiterates human relations. Jesus reiterates human relations. While Jesus was departing from human life, Jesus told his mother, "Woman, here is your son." And Jesus told to his beloved disciple, "Here is your mother." This particular text needs to be read contextually. We read so many incidents in the newspaper almost daily about disgraceful relationships in the family. In some incidents, parents are not respected as parents. In some incidents, children are not considered as children. They kill each other, they fight each other, they file case against each other, they spread bad things, bad news about each other in family and society, and the list goes on. In some incidents, we see it's extreme to the extent of illegal and ethical relationship between parents and children, illicit and incest relations. In this particular context, we need to re-listen the word of Jesus on the cross as, "A woman, remember that this is your son. A man, remember that this is your daughter. Hey children, remember that this is your parent." Realization of the nature of relations and the significance to keep them with their own dignity will help us to solve a lot of problems in our family and society which we face today. Before we think, speak, and do something in family and society, we need to remember to whom I am speaking or doing something. Dear brothers and sisters, even when Jesus was facing his death, he was concerned about his mother, and he is teaching us to be mindful of our relations and to fulfill our responsibilities towards them. May God help us to live understanding the meaning and value of human relations. Amen.
Sincere thanks to Reverend Dr. Ben Das for leading us in our meditation, and our gratitude to our choir for this special song. Now we'll be having a reflection.
Reflection. Oh my people, oh my church, what I have done to you, or in what have I offended you? Answer me. I sent a spirit of truth to guide you, and you close your hearts to the counselor. I pray that all may be one in the Father and me, but you continue to quarrel and divide. I call you to go and bring forth fruit, but you cast lots for my clothing, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy is God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. Gracious God, you call all people, male and female, strong and weak, rich and poor, to be your servants. Many a time in our lives, we tend to ignore your calling. We also tend to make a claim of the call which we have not received. You call us to be members of your faithful community, where we experience and share your love and concern with one another. Standing before the cross, we listen to your words, through which you created a new community of the faithful. May the cross help us to be mindful of the call to live as a caring community and cross over from our selfish ways. Amen.
Shall we sing hymn number 142? 142, At the Cross, Her Station Keeping. Please be seated. Now I invite Reverend G. Wilson to lead us in the meditation on the fourth word, the word of anguish.
Dear brothers and sisters, it is indeed a joy that we could be together to meditate upon the words from cross, the words that spoke of love outright. And it is indeed a joy that we celebrate these words, the word of the Lord, which is our life. At the outset, I would like to thank our dear pastor, Reverend Vincent Vinod Kumar, for ever being so kind and gentle and giving me this opportunity. Thank you, Aya, for this wonderful time. And also want to thank the pastoral team and the fellow preachers and the wonderful choir as ever before for bringing life into this worship. Let us pray. Our loving Father, every year we gather around your church to listen to the meditations from the cross. Every year passes by and we understand here and there and we retain some and we forget most. Today, dear Lord, as we look up to you, we pray that you would speak to us definitely and that we would carry home that which you want us to carry home and to live by that word. To your glory, O Father, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When we begin this 40 days of Lent, and particularly when we are moved into the Holy Week, we see that Jesus Christ organized every moment. On the Palm Sunday, he called out his disciples and he said, "Go to the village opposite to you, Bethphage, and there you will find a donkey and a colt tied. Go and untie it and bring it to me. If anyone asks you why you are doing so," and the code word that was given by our Master Jesus Christ was, "The Master needs it." That's the code word. The disciples went and found as it was, and there was this conversation, "Why are you doing it?" They said, "The Master needs it," and he let him go, and they bring that to Jesus Christ. Jesus rides on the donkey into the most contentious place, Jerusalem. As we have heard on the Palm Sunday, there was in Jerusalem two powerful things marching, taking place. The Roman power that was there, and Jesus humble on a donkey, fulfilling the prophecy of Zechariah, 9th chapter, verse 9th verse. Jesus organized that. And now when we come to the Passover meal that we celebrated last night, the Maundy Thursday, the disciples again asked Jesus, "Where do you wish to have the Passover meal?" And Jesus said, "Go to this village. There is a man carrying water and a pitcher. Follow him. Follow him into the master's house and ask the master, where is the Passover meal can be eaten?" So Jesus was taking along to completely fulfill the prophecy that was spoken for him, and he took over the complete reign of the moment so that he could be the Passover lamb for you and me. When Jesus cried out from the cross, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," immediately the crowd got disturbed. They said, "He is calling out Elijah." Well, the truth is, we all know that Jesus was saying, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And the first time the Lord Jesus Christ saying, my God. It's something, you know, kind of taken away from his relationship. But at that moment, it is described in Matthew's gospel and both in Mark's gospel as well. Now, from the sixth hour, there was darkness all over the land. The nature was reacting to the crucifixion of Christ. The nature cannot look at the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, hanging on the cross. And there was reactions from the nature. And there was darkness over the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? And then we know that they were immediately misunderstood to be that Jesus was calling Elijah. And then we see, and one of them at once ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on the reed and gave it to him. Once again fulfilling the prophecy. In my thirst, in my need, they give me a bitter drink. So Jesus was fulfilling everything that was written about him. Further on, if we read in the same chapter, that is Matthew 27, we see that there was the curtain at the temple completely, you know, divided from top to bottom. And the top to bottom, it was broken. It was divided. And not only that, there was another reaction, natural reaction. The tombs were open. The saints rose from the dead. And they presented themselves in the holy city. The cry of the Lord. The cry of the Lord, once again, is from Psalm 22, verse 1. And that's what David wrote years and years before Jesus is coming into the world. Everything was according to what the scripture was saying. Everything according to the plan of God. There is nothing that he was individually doing, but everything he has taken it to fulfill what was spoken about him in this world. And now the question that we need to ask is, can God forsake anyone? Can God forsake anyone? We know for sure that this is not so. In Isaiah chapter 59, verse 2, it says, your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God. Your sins have hidden his face. Sin is so powerful that it can, you know, completely separate relationship. My dear brothers and sisters, we are all Christians. We are all seated here. We talk about love. We talk more about sin than anything else. We meditate upon or think about sin. But have you ever seen and experienced and meditated upon the fact how my sin has caused division in the family? How my sin has brought disunity in a community? How many times have we thought about my sin, how much it has affected other people? And if you casually go around the streets or sit in a hotel when you hear people overhearing, you know, talking about what they are discussing usually, it is usually about people. It's usually about that person has done to me, this woman has done that to me, that young man has done to me. You know, it's always people. It is the sin of one affecting the rest of us. One of the explanations, you know, that we see in the life of everybody is this. It is people who caused me pain. It is people and the relatives who caused me this. The separation had taken place not because of my sin, it is because of others. And most of the time, we are also one of that and we forget it. And that is a painful thing. that there could be no reformation because we are overtly concentrating on those others and their sin in our life affecting us. And we do not know how much of sin that we have has caused separation, division, pain and suffering to those around us. If only we can think about it. And there was once a very big problem that was taking place. And there was, the people were asking, what is the way out? And they said, this community has got weapons, so what do you do? I will make sure all the weapons are removed. The weapons were removed. Still there were fighting. Still there were problems. And then another effort was made. How should we make war cease in our community? How can we stop this kind of enmity between each other? And then one young and a small child said, let them feel how it feels when they hurt each other. And that seems to have been one of the best suggestions. And immediately that was put in place. And everyone should know what happens when you do certain things. When people began to see how their actions and reactions, their words have affected people, then they began to feel sorry for that. Then they understood the power of sin in their own personal lives. When God created the world, when he called out Adam and Eve, and when he gave them the instruction saying, you shall not eat this fruit. The day you eat, you shall die. And another explanation for that is, if you eat this fruit, when you bring death upon yourself, when you bring the curse upon yourself, and it finally makes me to die in your place. It's not only you are dying. You have created a situation where the Creator God himself had to come back to die in your place to bring back salvation to humanity. And I'm sure that's a very beautiful way of looking at it. When I trespass God's command, I am affected. As a consequence, my Father in heaven, our Father in heaven, he has to come into this world to die for us and to save each one of us from sin. And that's what the Bible says in Paul to his letter to the Corinthian church, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, he says, God made Jesus Christ a sin for us because Jesus Christ becomes the victim on our behalf. We do something affecting the Godhead. It's not that we cannot, because it is love relationship between you and your God. And that's why John, in his writing in the Gospel, he says, behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. And the love of God fills the whole earth. And we are related, and this love of God cannot keep quiet. And the love of God comes at every point of time in order to bridge that separation, in order to separate us from the power of the sin and to unite us with the power of God's love. My dear brothers and sisters, we are his first love. Whether we love him or not, God's first love is human beings. God's first love is human beings. And that's why in the book of Revelation, chapter 21 and 3, it says beautifully, behold, the dwelling place of God is with his people. It is his people that matters. Here we see that sin destroys lives. Sin misleads people. Sin destroys families. Sin destroys oneself so deeply. If only we can realize the power of sin in our own life, and then we will know that it is God who heals us and who is separated because of our sin. When St. Paul was writing his letter to the Roman believers, he said, "Knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure," please listen to it, "for I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height or depth, nor anything else in all the creation will be able to separate us from the love of God." That is the truth. That is the truth that we have in the scripture. In this congregation, among us, in the community where we are, in the office that we are there, there are people, and the people, each one, are lonely. Each one is separated. And that's why someone very beautifully said, an anonymous individual in the lonely crowd. Anonymous individual in the lonely crowd. My dear brothers and sisters, nothing can separate us from the love of God. In the place where need to be separated, Jesus was separated, and Jesus has given us that hope. Nothing can separate. We are in the loving protection of God Almighty, that is Jesus our Father. Let us pray. Our most gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we thank you, dear Lord. Yes, we belong to these anonymous individuals in the lonely crowd. The crowd is lonely. Each individual has become anonymous. There is separateness in all of us. But in this, O Lord, we have a hope. The hope that Jesus Christ, because of his death and resurrection, he has connected us with God the Father in Christ. That we are connected. We are connected because of your love. We are connected because of your death. We are connected because of what you are. Teach us, O Father, that we carry this message, that we do not feel separated from anyone, that we belong to you, we belong to a community, we belong to each other. In Jesus' name we pray.
Our words fail to express our gratitude to Reverend G. Wilson for leading us in the meditation of the fourth word. We are grateful to him for ministering to us. Let us reflect. Let us all stand.
O my people, O my church, what have I done to you, or in what have I offended you? Answer me. My peace I gave, which the world cannot give, and washed your feet as a sign of my love. But you draw the sword to strike me in my name, and seek high places in my kingdom. I offered you my body and blood, but you scatter, deny, and abandon me, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy is God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal. Have mercy on us. Gracious God, you came into your own, but your own did not accept you. You lived a life of a wanderer without a place to rest your head. You humbled yourself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. Your instruction to carry up the cross and follow you is too much of a burden for us. But you carried the burden of the cross, the burden of our sins, and suffered the agony and pain. Standing before the cross, we see the extent to which you identified with the suffering humanity and heard their cry. May the cross help us to stand by the side of the oppressed and the enslaved, and cross over from the side of the structures that are oppressive. Amen.
Please be seated. Let us move on. Let us meditate on the fifth word, the word of suffering. Shall we look to God in prayer? Lord Jesus, as we reflect your fifth word spoken from the cross, fill them with your fresh meaning for each one of us. Help us to hear them with understanding, to receive them with penitence, and to respond to them with faith. In your holy name we pray. Amen. My beloveds in Christ, it has been a blessing to each one of us to meditate our Savior's words on the cross. John, in his Gospel, chapter 19, verse 28, says, "When Jesus knew that all was finished, he said, 'I am thirsty.'" How do we understand this verse? How do we interpret this verse, which has the word of our Savior? At the outset, we can understand that this was a feeling out of natural human experience. We all know that from the time of arrest at Garden of Gethsemane until he was crucified at Golgotha, Jesus suffered physically with great agony and pain, which is indescribable. On one hand, he is physically suffering. Moreover, he was stabbed, and the wounds were causing drain of his blood from his body, and that was causing thirst in his body. Not only physical strain, there was even mental preoccupation. It was too intense, and that could have been a cause of his bodily want. The agonies of horrible punishment, the sufferings of the physical torture, and the pain inflicted on the mind, everything culminated in the natural human expression of thirst. Jesus' feeling of thirst is a natural expression. This was caused by his own fellow beings, and it was very agonizing. It was out of agonizing relationship with the people around him. Secondly, Jesus' feeling of thirst is an echo of human feeling. It's not only human experience, it is also human feeling. The cry of Jesus, "I thirst," is an echo of human agony and suffering everywhere, everywhere. We did not go out to see the agonies of suffering. In our own country, in many states, including our own state of Karnataka, our soil is dry. Everyone is praying for rain, and we are eagerly longing for rain. We are looking for clean, fresh water for our own survival, for our own health. It is agonizing to see, and very painful to see, children are made to skip their schooling, and children are lowered into the wells to fetch water. It's so painful to see them, you know, risking themselves to fetch water for their family. It's more painful to see women carrying 3 to 4 earthen pots on their head, walking miles together to fetch water for their family. And many of them walk miles disappointed by not getting water. Farmers are committing suicide. Our agriculture has failed. Our cattle is worst affected by the drought. They're helpless creature. They only look up to us for their survival. And we are getting into a very bleak situation. Shocking is the politics on water. We are unable to understand how the leaders of our nation don't care for this basic need, and they play politics on water. As we ponder upon these things, facts in our own country, it is unimaginable, or it is so difficult to understand what is happening in Palestine, in Ukraine, where innocent people are killed. They are no way involved in any of these cause for war, but they are killed. They're innocent. Their livelihood is destroyed. When we see visuals every day, we are unable to accept it. It is horrible to see the way their habitat is destroyed, and basic essentials are denied for those people. On one hand, there is loss of life. On the other hand, they don't have anything to survive. And no one is willing to help them in their predicament. We cannot understand this politics. Politics involved in these countries. So when Jesus echoes pain and suffering, he is actually echoing the pain and suffering of innocent people, helpless and hopeless people. Thirdly, Jesus' feeling of thirst is an echo of human need. At the time of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus reminded, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness." The world in which we live is not bothered about hunger, or even they do not know what is righteousness also. In the world that we live today, the society to which we belong is deprived of justice. If you make a statement, you'll be watched. Even WhatsApp messages are watched. There is no caring, there's no love, there's no acceptance, there's no mutual trust, and we have lost the true community living which we were enjoying all these years. The new way of life that is opened on the One Global Village concept has forced many people to crave for peace and cry for justice, because they're denied peace, they're denied justice in the name of globalization. In the process of globalization, people are losing lives, their livelihood, and their future. People everywhere are hungry for justice, hungry for basic needs, hungry for minimum human rights, even to the extent of even getting pure drinking water. So the cry of Jesus on the cross is an echo of the cry of human need for justice, for basic needs and for minimum human rights. Fourthly, Jesus' feeling of thirst is an echo of human brutality. We note from scripture, the people stood by the cross offered Jesus vinegar when he said, "I thirst." Imagine you are asking for water and somebody feeds you vinegar. It is recorded that they soaked a sponge in vinegar and put the sponge on the stalk of a hyssop plant and lifted it to Jesus' lips. And they say that vinegar, which is mixed with myrrh, they say that it induces numbness from pain. And the scriptures, especially the gospel, according to Matthew as well as Mark, they say that Jesus refused the drink. He did not. But however, John says he accepted the drink. We really do not know what happened. But even at that point, people are not willing to show Jesus any mercy. Even he is at the time of death. They know that any time, he would die, in spite of looking at it, no one was willing to help him. The soldiers around him were also not sympathetic. Instead of water, they gave him wine. This is the way, even today, when you say your thirst, when you ask for something, it won't be given. It would be met with raw deal. That's the way the world treats you today. So Jesus's cry for thirst is an echo of human brutality. This is the way people are indifferent, inhuman, and this is the way they react. Fifthly and lastly, Jesus' feeling of thirst is an echo from the scripture. John records that Jesus, knowing that all was finished, to fulfill the scripture, he said, "I thirst." So from this verse, we infer that Jesus was not actually asking for water or anything. He was just fulfilling the scripture prophecy. And Jesus always said that he came to this world to fulfill the scriptures. And fulfillment was restoration of relationship with God. Even in this cry, he was appealing to people to be more humane, to be more understanding, more sympathetic, show love, care, and mercy. It was an appeal. In that process, at each point, Jesus consciously was fulfilling the scripture responsibility. Things that happened in Jesus' life, as well as the things he deliberately did, were all according to scripture. And you'll be really surprised. It was prophesied in Psalm 69, verse 21. It says, "They gave me poison for food, and for my thirst, they gave me sour wine to drink." It says sour wine, but it was horrible vinegar that they gave. There's also other dimension to the fulfillment of the scripture. The cry from Jesus that "I thirst" may sound like a contrast, hearing what Jesus had already said or claimed during his ministry. Jesus in Jerusalem, in the temple, he stood and he invited all people, saying, "If any one of you thirst, let him or her come to me, and I will satisfy his or her thirst." This was Jesus' claim. Jesus stood at the well of Jacob in Samaria, and talking to that Samaritan woman, he said, "Everyone who drinks this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give will never thirst. When we recollect to our minds these claims of Jesus, we find it to be contrasting to what has happened on the cross. Perhaps this is a contrast in his life throughout. He has everything. He is the cause of creating everything. And yet he had nothing. He was able to enrich the life of others, but he always led a life of a poor man. He said, "I am the bread of life." Yet in the scripture, we note that there were many occasions when he was hungry. He promised mansions for those who believed in him, and yet he had to say to himself, "Foxes have holes, the birds of the air have nests, yet the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." Such was the life of Jesus. And in spite of that kind of a life, he always focused on the word of God that proceeded from the mouth of God. And he wanted to fulfill the scripture. Jesus' feeling of thirst was a natural human experience. It is, however, an echo of human feeling. It's also an echo of human need. It is also an echo of human brutality. And it is also an echo of scripture. Jesus's thirst should awaken each one of us. It should awaken each one of us to be sensitive, to be human, to be like Jesus, having the mind of Jesus, to show all the needed help and grace to whoever is in any kind of these kind of situations. We have to be sensitive to human feeling, human experience, human need. And when they're going through brutality, we have to show our care, compassion, and mercy on those dear ones, because they're victimized, they're helpless, they're hopeless. Anytime they would die, and it is our duty to intervene and help them. And it's also very important that we long and seek justice and peace. It's very important. A God always expects from each one of us to seek justice in whatever situation, whatever circumstances, whatever challenges are, always to seek justice and work towards peace. What would create peace? We need to attempt to achieve it and to protect and nurture the creation, because God has entrusted this beautiful creation to our care. And it is our duty to see to that we protect and nurture our creation so that we would be accountable to the future generation. Thirsting Jesus calls each one of us to quench our thirst by not mere destruction of resources, but by saving it, He's looking up to each one of us so that we, in response to the message of the cry of thirst on the cross, we would respond by our human compassion, love, care, and concern, and we would take the responsibility to care for the nature and this beautiful creation. May God continue to speak to hearts. Amen. Let us stretch ourselves, let us stand and sing to the glory of God, hymn number 144. His are the thousand sparkling rills. Please be seated. Let us reflect on the fifth word.
O my people, O my church, what I have done to you, or in what have I offended you? Answer me. What more could I have done for you that I have not done? I planted you, my chosen and fairest vineyard. I made you the branches of my vine. But when I was thirsty, you gave me vinegar to drink and pierced the side of your Savior with a spear, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. Gracious God, you have created the oceans and the seas. You are the source of the living water, and you are the preserver of life. You said, whoever drinks the water I give will never thirst. In your suffering for the sinful humanity, you fully experience the agony and thirst. Standing before the cross, we see your continuing thirst and hunger for justice, peace, and reconciliation. May the cross help us to thirst for a just and inclusive community, where the needs of the weak and the lonely will be our concern, and help us to cross over to see the lost. Amen.
Now I invite Reverend Dr. Moses Jayakumar to kindly come forward and lead us in our meditation on the sixth word, word of victory.
Meditation on the sixth word from the cross. It is finished. Three words in English language and one word, tetelestoi, in Greek, considered to be the greatest word from the greatest man on the greatest day in all eternity. And this word has changed the history and the destiny of humankind. The four gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, describe the last days of Jesus in different ways. There are similarities, there are variations. When it comes to the last words that Jesus spoke from the cross, Matthew and Mark mention one particular word and say, with that Jesus breathed its last. Luke gives us three verses, and after the third word, according to Luke, Jesus gave His spirit. John also listing three verses, and at the end of the third, that is, it is finished, Jesus breathed its last. When John is listing out the three verses from the cross, if you read the passage from John 19, 25 to 30. The five verses, all the three verses are mentioned, and it happens in a quick succession. Maybe in a matter of 5 minutes, everything is over. Whereas in Luke, when he mentions three verses, there is some gap between the first, second, and the third. But in these three verses happening in three very quick succession, I thirst. Before that, the third verse, Mother, your son, and to the disciple, He said, your mother. Then I thirst. It is finished. All is happening in very quick succession. Maybe it says, it shows that all these are happening towards the end of Jesus' life on earth. Towards the end of Jesus' life on earth. And each gospel writer has his own background and has his own purpose to write the gospel. Particularly, John's motive, purpose is to declare, establish that Jesus is the Son of God. He begins the gospel by saying, in the beginning was the Word. That is the beginning about Jesus. Later he says, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That is Jesus' incarnation. And towards the end, in chapter 20, he says, all these are written with a purpose. And the purpose is, those who read this will believe that Jesus is Christ, Jesus is the Son of God. And that they, by believing, they may have life in his name. What is meant by this, when John says, this is my motive, this is my purpose, when Jesus, the Christ, the Son of God, is saying it is finished, through those words also Jesus is declaring that he is the Son of God. The words from the cross is also telling us that he is the Son of God. The word that is became flesh is the one that is saying it is finished. And he is the Son of God. Jesus took the form of a human in order to reveal the love of God. And when he says it is finished, we understand that he revealed his Father's love towards the whole of humanity, fully, completely. Total and absolute revelation of God's love towards human beings. The love of God. God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. He came and revealed the love of the Father towards the people in fullness, in all its fullness. Not only revealing the love of God, but also when he took the form of human by becoming flesh, he assumed a complete human nature. He experienced all the limitations of humanity. He experienced hunger, thirst, weariness, and finally suffered on the cross. By accepting the suffering on the cross, he fully identified with human nature. The greatness of our faith, which other people cannot understand, is the Son of God became human and he died for us on the cross. He took our punishment upon his shoulders. This nobody can understand. And he did that without sacrificing his divinity, without diluting the divine nature that was in him. And someone is describing this in these words. Without ceasing to be what he was, he became what he was not. Without ceasing to be what he was, he became what he was not. It is finished. It's the declaration to say that he lived a perfect human life to its completion. The Greek word tetelestai, one word, meaning it is accomplished, it is finished, it is fulfilled. This word was used in different contexts. It was used in a religious context. A devotee will bring the animal for sacrifice. It is the responsibility or duty of the priest to examine if there is any deformity. And the priest always finds animals with some deformity. And supposing if a devotee is bringing an animal without any blemish, without any defilement, the priest will be terribly happy. He will be very delighted. He will be very satisfied. And he will say, tetelestai. It is finished. Which means the demand of the law is finished. It is accomplished by bringing an unblemished animal for sacrifice. They also say it will be used by an artist. An artist, having completed his work, giving the final touches, he stood back to admire his own creation. When he realized that nothing is called for any correction or improvement, he said, "Tetelestai, it is finished. It is accomplished." It is important to observe this context. The context is, if there is nothing called for correction or improvement to his work, he says, "Tetelestai." When Jesus says, "It is finished," it means there's nothing more to be added. There's no more correction. There's no one coming after Jesus to correct what he has done. There's no one is going to add anything. No one is there to give any final touches to what he has already accomplished. His work is final and complete. It is complete in all its fullness. Considering the scene that was unfolding in Calvary, "It is finished," those words should not come from the cross. It should come from some other group or section of people. It should come from the religious group. They planned every move very carefully, criminal act of the people, to see that Jesus is eliminated. After arresting him, they were searching for suitable evidences to pronounce the death sentence on Jesus. One main accusation was he calls himself as the Son of God. According to Luke's gospel, they also tried to levy some political charges against him, saying that he instigated people against the Roman Empire. But those charges did not find any basis for the Roman authorities. So the leaders had to rely only on this charge: he called himself as the Son of God. And with that charge, they were very successful to get the order from Pilate to nail him on the cross. All this they did very carefully because Jesus was interfering in their lives. Jesus was interfering in their lifestyle, in their priestly rituals, and affecting their social justice. In their so-called social status, what they pronounced as social justice to other people, Jesus disturbed that. So out of selfish motives, they tried to eliminate him. And they were very successful to convince Pilate to get this order. It is for them to say, "It is finished. We have eliminated him. Our conspiracy has worked. He is finished. And our work is finished." It should come from the Roman authorities. When Pilate heard that Jesus is a Galilean, he sent him to Herod. Herod was a dummy king, but when Jesus was sent by Pilate, he was very happy that he is being recognized. And he tried to question Jesus, but Jesus never answered anything. He would have thought, "I got rid of John the Baptist, and this new preacher will also be finished." But Jesus did not answer. So he sent Jesus back to Pilate. Though Pilate was not convinced of the charges that the people, the leaders, were levying against Jesus, he came and spoke to the leader, saying that, "I did not find him guilty." But they were crying, they were shouting, "Crucify him." So in order to satisfy his ego, what he did, he asked the people to flog him and mock at him. Finally, he handed over Jesus to be crucified. Pilate could have said, "The one who questioned my authority is standing in front of my authority, and soon he will be dead. He is finished, and all his followers are finished." But the powerful groups had the reasons to say it is finished, but they did not have the opportunity to say that. Because those who were in power and authority, who orchestrated the death sentence, could not say it is finished, because the final words of victory are coming from Jesus. coming from the mouth of a dying man, shouting in a loud voice, "It is finished." All the four gospel writers say this. He shouted with a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. It is generally believed that it was not easy for a man who had been flogged and made to suffer the maximum pain through inhuman treatments and finally nailed to the cross to have any energy to speak, even to whisper. He'll be choked to death. Neither the Roman authorities nor the Jewish religious leaders could take his life away from him. Jesus derived all his energy and in a loud voice said, "It is finished." He wanted everyone to know that it is finished and it is he who is giving up his spirit. Be reminded of the words of Jesus in John, "I lay down my life, no one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have power to lay it down." It is finished. Is not a shout of defeat, but a shout of victory. No other individual or group or power could say, "It is finished." I came across a phrase that gives apt description to this context. And the phrase is, "Nothing was finished until Jesus said it was finished." Nothing was finished until Jesus said it was finished. John gives a very brief background note to the sayings of Jesus. He says, "After this, knowing all that was now finished, to fulfill the scripture, Jesus said, 'I thirst.'" In the same context for the next word also, "Knowing that all was now finished, he said, 'It is finished.'" The fulfillment of the scriptures is also part of the accomplishment. We heard that already. It is not the fulfillment of any particular text or particular verse, but the fulfillment of what the Bible said about the Messiah, the anointed, the Christ. The work of the Messiah, as it is written in the scripture, is fulfilled. There is nothing more to be completed or fulfilled, and there is no other person who can fulfill. There are some important words that John uses in his gospel, and two words I wish to pick up. Time and glory. We find both these words in the first miracle, the sign, which John calls it, not miracle, that is a wedding at Cana. Jesus said, "My time has not come." Towards the end of the narrative, we read, "In this way, Jesus manifested his glory." Both time and glory, according to Jesus, are linked to his messianic identity. According to John, when Jesus was teaching in the temple, the leaders wanted to arrest him, but they did not because his hour has not yet come. Later, Jesus himself made a statement combining hour, time, and glory. "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." To be glorified refers to the suffering on the cross, suffering of the Messiah. Cross was not just the culmination of his suffering. It was a bold proclamation that all that Christ came to do on this earth was accomplished. We have seen his glory. We have seen his glory when he took the form of a human child, when the Word became flesh. We see his glory when he's lifted up on the cross. While the leaders at the time were seeking their own personal glory, when his own disciples were more concerned about their personal positions, Jesus declared and demonstrated that his glory is to lay down his life to redeem the whole world. This he accomplished on the cross, and it is finished. Cross is a symbol of hope and victory. The loud voice of the suffering servant declares that he is the victorious. And through these words, he is inviting you and me to seek him when there are burdens to bear and rugged roads to cross in our own life's journey. Jesus' invitation to you and me is to deny ourselves and carry the cross and follow him. It is the way of the cross. Our burdens cannot be compared with the burden of sin that Jesus carried on the cross. He is the one who makes things impossible possible. There's a beautiful song that goes like this, many of you would know. I know the odds look staked against you, and it seems there is no way out. I know the issue seems unchangeable, and there is no reason to shout. But the impossible is God's chance to work a miracle. A miracle. So just know, it is not over until God says it is over. When we go through times of agony and disappointment, when we feel that we are totally defeated, when we feel that we are too weak and helpless, as people who believe in our Savior Jesus Christ, we should believe that nothing is finished until Jesus said it was finished. Because the saying of Jesus is not a sign of defeat, but a sign of victory. Amen.
Thank you, Moses Ayah, for leading us in our meditation on the sixth word. Shall we all stand for the reflection?
Oh, my people. O my church, what have I done to you, or in what have I offended you? Answer me. I grafted you into the tree of my chosen Israel, and you turned on them with persecution and mass murder. I made you joint heirs with them of my covenants, but you made them scapegoats for your own guilt, and you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy is God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. Gracious God, you came into the world to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, give sight to the blind, and to release the oppressed. This was fulfilled in and through your ministry. Those who were set free regained their sight, received complete healing, regained human dignity, and re-entered active social life, praising and glorifying you. They went around proclaiming your mighty deeds. The religious leaders, on the other hand, suspected everything that happened, and they wanted to finish off the Son of God. Standing before the cross, we hear your cry of victory and accomplishment through your suffering on the cross. May the cross help us to humble ourselves, to receive the gift of liberation and freedom, and help us to overcome to your path of fulfillment. Amen.
Please be seated. We move on to the meditation on the seventh word. Word of commitment led by Reverend Sam Chabadurai.
Let us pray. God the Redeemer, God the Liberator, God the Victor, we seek your guidance as we meditate on the profound utterance of Jesus Christ on the cross. Help us to understand and intake the very words of life into our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Seventh word of Jesus Christ on the cross. The final shouting of Jesus Christ on the cross, it is a prayer. It is a prayer of commitment. It is a prayer of perseverance. It is the prayer of Jesus Christ, who has completed his assigned task while he was in this earth as a human being. The passage which is reflected in the scripture, St. Luke chapter 23, passage beginning from 44 to 49, it goes on like this. Jesus Christ made a huge cry. In a sense, he shouted to the peak of his voice and healed his soul. The very prayer is, Father, into your hand I commit my spirit. This entire passage of St. Luke chapter 23, verses beginning from 44 to 49, gives us two profound words for our meditation today. The voice that Jesus made or raised, and the act of commitment. In verses 46, 47, Jesus did not pray this prayer in a silent voice. We can integrate the seven words just like this. The first three words being uttered for the people around him, and obviously that could not have any strength or which is not required any strength to make a loud noise or voice for Jesus to be heard. But thereafter, when we continue to see, he increases his voice, something unnatural. Initially, he could have had some little strength in his body, but here Jesus Christ somehow grabbled all his left out energies in the body and finally makes this statement of commitment. We know that in the context of Roman Empire, cross is an act of terror. It is the threat to the life. It was completely filled with horror and nightmares. When someone imagines the cross of Roman Empire, completely it will be shattered because it was so brutal for someone to experience this crucifixion. And we are not surprised. We as humankinds, we are only selfless for this death. For anything, any desire of this world, we act selfish. We always wanted to own or possess. Every act of life which is involuntary to us. But this very act of death, no one dares to accept or desires to happen into our life. But Jesus Christ made it happen in his life. The Roman government kept people in fear of death for the crime of insurrection and treason. Someone raising their voice against the ruling government. Someone who agitates against the policies and laws of the Roman government. It is sure they will be crucified or they will be brutally tortured to death. And Jesus, knowing everything throughout his life, he never hesitated to counter the injustice prevailed during his life on the earth. Be it his own Jewish community, his own religious leaders, where they had traditions and laws which had no life, but marginalized people who were in their own sect, in their own community. They had the privileged and underprivileged and people and who are no people. The categorization of the Jewish religious sect was also been countered by Jesus Christ during his life. They could not do anything with him, but they made a false accusation against Jesus Christ to be crucified, portraying that Jesus was against the Roman Empire. And Jesus, where the Roman government thought this would be the very end of this fellow, of this very much rebellious one who were always against the government policies and enactments in the social life. They thought they had crucified him. They have brutally murdered and projected him as a scene to the other people so that no one can dare act against the government. But Jesus challenged this very act of death by his loud cry even at the end of his life. Jesus did not say this prayer in a silent way. As we already remarked, it was a shout. It was a loud cry of prayer, though it was offered to the Father in heaven. Why he asked to make such a loud noise? He wanted the power and authority, the Roman government, to hear his cry of victory that they have no authority over his soul, of his life on this earth. He wanted to show to his own religious leaders that they had nothing done with regards to his life. And also, the cry was so loud for the sake of his own disciples who have disappeared during his arrest in the Garden of Gethsemane. And this voice is to ensure the restoration of life. And this voice of Jesus Christ is a voice of so many afflicted and unjustly. This voice of Jesus Christ reminds to us his commitment even to the death on the cross. Rightly as Paul mentions in Philippians chapter 2 verses 8 and 9, even unto the death on the cross, Jesus committed his life. And that was the commitment he is expecting us. This commitment was completely reflected through the voice of Jesus Christ, which shook the power and authority. When Pilate was told that Jesus has died, it was surprising for him. Gospel of Mark 15 verses 44 and 45 shows to us that Pilate, when he heard that the death of Jesus Christ, he was surprised. The voice shook the authority and the power. And this very voice, as it is mentioned in Luke chapter 23 verses 47, the voice of Jesus transformed the Roman centurion. And this voice of Jesus Christ spectacled the bystanders who were witnessing this striking, sensational, and natural event occurred because of this voice of Jesus Christ. It is such a powerful voice which has disturbed the true piety for centuries, even till today. This loud cry of Jesus Christ will disturb us, and we cannot be insensitive when we hear the voices of those who suffer just like Jesus on the cross for the sake of injustice and lifelessness. We as person and as faith community are called to listen and react to the voices of the co-sufferers of Jesus Christ and commit ourselves to the corporate salvation proclaimed on the cross. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, one of the renowned theologians of the early 20th century, he makes this statement like this: a church is a church only when it exists for others, no dominating but helping and serving. Jesus Christ made it affirmed on the cross. Hence, Jesus Christ said in Matthew 10:28, do not be worried about those who kill the flesh. We are encouraged by the life and death of Jesus Christ. We are not only empowered by the life of Jesus Christ, but also the very death of Jesus Christ has empowered us not to fear the death as we engage ourselves to the unjust life situation prevailing around us, but by the strength of Jesus Christ, by the loud voice of Jesus Christ on the cross, which keeps us awake, which keeps us sensitive to the unjust life situations around us. Hence, the voice cried out on the cross by Jesus Christ is a fourfold challenge for us. It is the challenge to the Roman authority. It is the challenge to the Jewish religious tradition. It is the challenge to the hiding disciples. And it is a challenge for us to be the voice of the voiceless, to hear the voices of the suffering, and to commit our life for ever fresh Christian faith. Are we ready to commit our life for Jesus Christ? Let's pray. God, you suffered along with the suffering community. As we commit ourselves, empower us, edify us, and strengthen us to face every consequences as we remain the voices of the voiceless in this society. Guide us and lead us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Sam, for your profound insights on the seventh word of our Savior on the cross. I invite St. Mark's Choir to kindly come forward and present the special song, "So the Sun Stood Still." Sincere thanks to St. Mark's Choir. May God bless our choir. We are grateful to them for all their presentations and for all their services to this great cathedral. May God bless them, bless their faith and faith actions. Shall we all stand for the reflection?
reflection, O my people, O my church, what have I done to you, or in what have I offended you? Answer me. I came to you as the least of your brothers and sisters. I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. And you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy is God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. Gracious God, you are the source of our being. Our breath is your gift. You came into the world as a poor human child to declare the love of God to all people. You constantly reveal through our words and deeds that you have come to do the will of the Father. You glorified the Father through your ministry. Standing before the cross, we hear your words through which you declared to the leaders who question your claim to be the Son of God, that you are indeed the Son of God, and that divine relationship cannot be taken away from power or authority of this world. May the cross help us to remain in that sacred relationship with the privilege to say Abba Father, and help us cross the boundaries that separate this relationship. Amen.
As we stand, let us affirm our faith as it is found in the words of Apostle Creed on page 10. Apostle Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated.
My beloveds in Christ, we are grateful to each one of you for your prayers, for your participation, and for the wonderful way you have enriched all our Lenten services, very especially the Good Friday noon service. Soon after this service, we request you to kindly join us for our fellowship. Refreshments have been prepared by the pastorate committee. We request you to kindly join us for this refreshment and time of fellowship. Please note, on Easter Day, our dawn service is at 5:30 a.m., our Choral Eucharist is at 9 a.m., and Holy Eucharist is at 11 a.m. We request you to kindly join us on Easter Day in the special services, and may God continue to do the good works that He has initiated in and through us. Our offertory hymn is hymn number 108. 108, Sing My Tongue, the Glorious Battle.
Let us present these offerings with them ourselves for the service of the Divine Majesty. Let us pray. Holy God, who through your dear Son has consecrated for us a new and living way to your throne of grace, we come to you through him unworthy as we are, and we humbly ask you to accept and use us and these our gifts for your glory. All that is in heaven and earth is yours, and of your own we give it to you. Amen.
Prayer, O Lord, has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. For the information of the congregation members, self-denial offering covers are kept at the doors. Please kindly collect them, and you can use this to offer your self-denial offering on Sunday, on Easter Day. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that Christ was raised from the dead. He cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. Let us receive God's blessings in faith. To God the Father, who has made us and all the world, to God the Son, who has redeemed us and all humankind, to God the Holy Spirit, who sanctifies us and all the elect people of God, be all the glory forever and ever. May the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each one of us now and forever. Amen. Lord be with you. Let us depart in peace.